So I know you've been speaking here in the Medtronic booth, and what does that do to your blood sugar? Getting up in front of the audience.
Well, yesterday with my constant monitoring system, I actually looked at it afterwards because I was nervous the first time, and I was like, I wonder if that changed my blood sugar levels. Mm-hmm. And it goes up a little bit, actually. A lot of times you think of things like when you're in a bad mood or when you're angry or adrenaline kicks in, that it changes your blood sugar. But it's weird that standing up and talking for 10 minutes and just being a little bit nervous, that it could really change your blood sugar that
much. Yeah, the cortisol, your body's... I was just talking to a nurse educator that's a runner, and she runs races a lot. And she said if she practices 2 miles in running, her blood sugar will go down. If it's a race, the 2 miles, the same distance, same exertion, her blood sugar goes up. So it's just...
In your brain.
In your brain. And it's releasing this cortisol and epinephrine.
Yeah, it's...
You probably have that when you compete.
Yeah, I just got my EMT license, and I'm starting to get into all the medical side of things, and I want to become a paramedic just for a backup plan for one day. And mm-hmm. All the medical side of diabetes is really starting to mean a lot more to me, and I'm really interested in finding out what happens to my blood sugar when I surf, and if it's small if I go surf, if it's the same as if I surf for the same amount of time on a big day. So I'm really excited about that.
So you're competing surfing?
Yep.
Where do you go? What kind of...
I'm currently on the ASP World Tour, and it's a worldwide tour with numerous contests in every country around the world that has an ocean, even some that you wouldn't want to go to with an ocean. Last year I went to Brazil, I went to Australia, Japan, Indonesia, I went to Bali, I went to Tasmania.
And you took your surfboard and you surfed and competed in all those places?
Surfed and competed everywhere.
How'd you do?
Really well. Last year was a good year. I got to, I recently got a significant girlfriend in my life, and traveling with her and getting to take someone on tour with you, like, really helps mentally.
Absolutely.
Like, I end up not missing home so badly, and it doesn't feel like you're alone for 2 weeks surfing.
Right.
And I think it honestly helped my surfing, and I had a really good year. I made some money and got to surf some incredible waves. And the tour is a lot about hanging out with your friends and big venues like this event actually is, they're surfing ones just like this, and it's exciting.
Have you surfed in Kauai on a lake?
I have. I've surfed in Kauai numerous times.
I love it there. The binoculars, you see these guys, they have to paddle out forever. They're way out in the ocean, and they stand up on this reef. It's like way out there. And then they get in again and they paddle, or somebody tugs them in a skidoo or whatever.
Yeah.
So those are like the big waves way out there, right?
Yeah, there's good waves like that out there. Kauai, I have a couple good friends on Kauai, and really good surfers. And it's really tropical, and it reminds me, actually, it's the closest island, I think, to the Big Island. And I live on the wet side of the Big Island, and Kauai feels like the Big Island all over again.
And what if you're way out there and you get hypoglycemia?
That's actually a good reason on why I'm excited about having a waterproof case for my pump. But luckily I've been able to get a hold of my blood sugars and keep... When I was first diagnosed, I had a really hard time with that. Before I'd even get to the waves, I'd have to turn around and eat a Snickers bar. I used to put 20 Snickers bars in my pocket before I'd go surf, and it was like the excitement of going surfing or paddling out and being like, oh, the waves are going off, it was like my blood sugar would drop rapid. And slowly over time, I've learned that, like, it's like my body's learned to let me go surfing, and that...
I like the way you said that.
It doesn't need to drop my blood sugar that fast. And at the same time, I've learned, especially with keeping my blood sugar so tight with my new constant monitoring system, I've learned that, when you keep it real tight in a tight window for a long time, anything outside of that window, you instantly start feeling. And I noticed that over when I had bad blood sugars, and my blood sugar would be 200, and then a couple hours later it would be 50. I didn't notice when I was 50 or 200.
Right.
And when you have it in real close, like in check, it could be 40 and it's like, I'll be like, I need to go in. Or 150 and I'll be like, I feel high. And it's like, it's a good feeling to know that your body knows to look out for you and tell you when it's like that. So
that's really being in tune. I like the way you describe that. So are you able to take Synchrospars out surfing with you, or what do you take with you?
I usually keep an ice chest on the beach with just some glucose tablets and the soda and some water anyways. And so usually I'll come in every couple of hours and check it. And I mean, if the waves are pumping, it's like I'll get there at 8 a.m. and leave at dark. So I definitely have to come in and resupply and check my blood sugar. And
wait, so if you get low weight, you have to come back to the beach?
Yeah.
You can't put like a tube of glucose gel or?
A couple kids that I surf with in Huntington do that. They put like Snickers bar, some candy bar, or something inside their wetsuit. Mm-hmm. And I used to keep the little waterproof glucose tablet gel mm-hmm. stuff.
Uh-huh.
I used to keep that in my pocket. But I guess I probably still should, but it just seems like I've gotten such good care of it. And I mean, I know bad things still happen on surprise. But,
no, but you're right. If you test before you go out there and you haven't just bullised, then yeah, you're probably not going to go low. I just remember that Kauai one. It seems like it's way out there.
Yeah, there's a couple waves on the tour that are like that. And I mean, I make sure I take stuff with me on waves where I'm going to be paddling a couple hundred yards before I even get to where I want to be.
Right.
And it's like a flat bay in between where it's going to take 10 minutes of paddling to get in. I'll usually take something with me, but my local spot is a valley on the Big Island where you can park on the sand and you surf 20 feet from the sand. So,
where's that?
Waipio Valley.
Oh, do you have to go down in the valley?
Yeah.
That's like a four-wheel drive.
Yeah.
Wow. Because I know the only white sand beach there is Hapuna.
Yeah. Waipio is a black sand beach, and I mean it's like home to me. I might as well just bring a bed in the back of my truck half the days. So I go down there, I stay until, from the second the sun comes up till it goes down, I was in the water, uh-huh. come out feeling like a lobster.
Uh-huh. Isn't there some politics with surfing and respecting the local people? I guess you are a local person now, is there?
When I first moved to the Big Island, it was like I felt like an outsider, and I felt like nobody liked me, and I didn't really have any friends or anyone to hang out with and surf. And it was like over time going to high school there, it's like I kind of made friends with, and then surfing the good contests or surfing big contests, it's like I met all the best surfers around the island. And slowly over the last years, it's like I've kind of made a name for myself over there. And it's like I don't really get hassled anymore. And I know like there's still guys on the island that surf better than me that I probably don't know, but I know mostly everybody that surfs YPO and have respect for them and get respect for them. Mm-hmm. So,
well, Scott Dunton, thanks for coming over to talk to us.
Thanks very much for having me. I appreciate it.